How's it going, everybody? It's PJ here from the Shuffle Squad, and I have brought to you a plethora of Pokemon players. We're going to go over the meta forecast for the upcoming Toronto Regionals hosted this weekend in Toronto, Canada, home place of Little Dark Fury, nonetheless. So we're going to go over some of our meta predictions, what we think is going to be good, what we think might fall off based off of LAIC, and kind of round everything out. So before we move any further, I'm going to let everybody introduce themselves, and we can go around. You already know me. If you're watching the channel, you know that I'm the manager of the Shuffle Squad, and help everybody out on the team. Love the community. I'm excited to play in Toronto, as you can tell, but I will kick it off with everybody else here.
I'm Michael. I mostly have played competitive pretty much my whole life. I started in 2010, got my first invite in 2012, and have competed every year since. My biggest accomplishments mostly came during the last season before COVID. I got two top eights and day two almost every regionals that season. So that's who I am.
What's up, everyone? I'm Ryan. Same with Katron. I've been playing since like 2010. And my most recent accomplishments were post-COVID, and they were NAIC 2016 or top 16 and Brazil top 16.
And I'm sure you all know who I am. LDF right here in the house. What's up, everybody? What's up?
All right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to kind of go through on our thoughts for LAIC, what we thought would happen, kind of did happen. Lugia came out in full force and just dominated that event. It was absolutely disgusting how many Lugia was actually played by some of the top players in the game. And it obviously ended up being the best deck to play that day. Even in finals, we had two Lugia decks mirror matched at the end to fill things out with Tord taking it home. So, Michael, if you want to talk a little bit about your thoughts on LAIC, we want to get some insight from you.
Going into LAIC, I think everyone knew Lugia was going to be the most played deck, probably the most successful deck, but I don't think people really expected every single top group to end up on Lugia aside from Azul's group. And it was pretty astounding to see everyone end up on the same deck. Very few people had anything really special about their list. It was all pretty straightforward, playing one Yveltal, one Charizard, and then pretty much consistency after that. John Eng's group brought the Raikou. Tord ended up playing a little bit more consistency, but it really was just only a Lugia event. I think the two other things that are going to kind of change are we're going to see a little bit more of control with Sander getting a top eight placement with a pretty straightforward list that has a very solid strategy against Lugia. And then actually Ryan's deck that he got top 16 with the heavy path Mew that also played Lost City. I think that has a pretty good matchup into Lugia and can play a pretty well-rounded field aside from Lugia.
Yeah, now Ryan, you actually top 16'd LAIC, so congrats on that as well.
Thank you.
But you decided to go play Mew, which I thought, to be honest with you, was the best meta call for that whole tournament going into it, you know, blindly. I think that Mew was a solid deck beforehand, but tell me your thoughts. You were out there on the field playing.
Yeah, so the day before I was like back and forth between Lugia and Mew, and I had no idea what I was going to play. I was testing with my friend Ian Robb, and we were just grinding games. Mm-hmm. And before, I had no Heroes Medal in my list. And we played, and he pretty much destroyed me, unless I Marnie Pathed and he Dedro. I was not winning any games, and I'm like, all right, I'm on Lugia. But I'm like, I don't want to play Lugia, because I just don't want to play Mirrors, and I really want to play Mew, because that's the deck I'm best with as well. And I'm like, wait, what about Heroes Metal? That might make you win the matchup. Because usually, Lugia goes four powerfuls and a choice spell on Lugia to kill the first Mew. And then the second Mew, they Yveltal to kill it. And then after that, they're out of steam. So I'm like, if we can Heroes Metal one of the Mews, they'll be at one prize, and then they'll be out of steam, and I should win the game from there. I didn't actually know that Yveltal goes through Heroes Metal. So I actually went 2-4 against Lugias at LAIC. I was beating everything else, surprisingly. But yeah, I think Lugia that event was by far the best deck. I think it's going to be the best deck for Toronto as well. So yeah, those are my thoughts.
Awesome. And LDF and I kind of watch from the sidelines here. So LDF, what was your take on LAIC and the meta that grew from that?
Yeah, no, I'm definitely not surprised to see Lugia like dominate so hard. And I've seen a lot of like discourse on Twitter with people saying like, oh, it's, you know, the end of the format, blah, blah, blah. Like everybody's like just panicking over Lugia. But it's crazy because we've seen this before with like, we saw it with Palkia when like the whole top eight in Australia was nothing but Palkia decks. The format is still kind of just people still got to figure stuff out. Obviously, Lugia is by far none the BDIF, and there's a lot of ways you can actually play Lugia too. There's a lot of different tech cards you can play. Obviously, we've seen the Yveltal, the Charizard, and the Raikou, and the Stoutland be really good in the deck, but there could be other things people come up with. I think Lugia winning LEIC was not a surprise, and it wasn't surprising to see it be like the most popular deck, right? You know, the second best deck at LEIC was obviously Lost Box, which Azul's group was on. They were on that Lost Box, Kyogre, Raikou deck. And that deck does seem decent against Lugia. It just sucks that Lugia can play Stoutland. And I still think Lugia has to play Stoutland going into Toronto, obviously, because Lost Box is still going to be very, very popular. Because Lost Box is one of the only decks that I think can stand up to Lugia that doesn't fold as easily. Obviously, the Stoutland is a problem, but I do think Lost Box is still good for Toronto. And I'm not surprised to see Lost Box do, you know, the second best at the tournament. And then, obviously, Mew was like kind of like the third best deck. Mew can just beat Lugia sometimes by just like sheer raw power and being fast. Mew is still probably like the third best deck to play going into Toronto. And it's awesome to see Ryan, you know, how you got top 16 with it, using that Heroes Metal, which is like a really cool innovation and tech card in Mew. So it's really cool to kind of see Mew still innovate and come up with new ideas to like work, because we've seen Mew before kind of just straight consistent with Crematics, and then we've seen Catchers, but now we're kind of seeing people play a little bit more of like a controlling game with cards like Path to Peak. And I know Azul had that like Path Lost Vacuum deck that he won a tournament with, so there's still a lot of potential for Mew, and I think Mew can still beat Lugia fairly well also. And I think Lugia will still be the deck to beat. A lot of people are just going to net deck towards deck going into Toronto, so I think you still have to beat Lugia, and you still have to have a good matchup against Lugia going into Toronto. And I'm not surprised to see it win LAIC at all.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I think that will kind of corner us into the predictions going into Toronto, because I have quite a few. I love the Theorymon quite a bit on what I think is going to be great for the next upcoming big championship tournament. And to be honest with you, I would say, you know, Mew might come out swinging, but not your normal Mew. You know, obviously Ryan was playing the Path Mew, you know, Azul was one of the ones who heavily promoted that coming out of the gate, where you have the heavy Path, you have the heavy Loss Vacuum. I really think that we might see a swing towards something like you know, a tanking Mew, maybe something with Big Parasol. I think the heavy tank and heal decks might come out to play for Toronto. I really think that that might be a direction that people tend to go, because you're not necessarily going to, you know, just power through a Lugia deck consistently. Lost Box can do it, I'm sure. But we saw, you know, obviously Lost Box fall towards the top here. And I think that Mew has a lot of plays around that. There's other decks that I think can play really well into Lost Box and also Lugia that we didn't necessarily see in LAIC. So that's my general prediction. Obviously, we've seen other decks start to come out of the woodwork. The Weezing decks are starting to show up, which I love that card, but I really don't think it's good. And then we have the, you know, special energy counters like the Beedrill, the single strike Beedrill, come out too in other decks like the Arceus, and then just straight up Inteleon Beedrill, which has seen some success as of late as well. So, Michael, if you want to go in on some of your predictions, put your tinfoil hat on. That's this section here of the video, and let us know what you think for the next upcoming tournament.
I guess for Toronto, the biggest thing is I think we see a the addition of Glissey V to a lot of Lugia lists, and I think that's going to be added just as a nice way to counter the control variant. Sanders list doesn't really have a great way to handle you going into a Glissey V. Eventually, they will promote Milk Tank, and then you're able to retrieve Glissey V eventually, even if they do run you on energies a little bit for a few turns. You can always just keep one attached and eventually retreat. So it really doesn't have an answer to Blissey in Lugia, so I think that's going to be a big addition to Lugia during the event, and it's also pretty good against Lost Box, which will make Lugia a lot stronger. So I think Lugia is still going to remain probably the most dominant deck in the game. I don't think decks like Lost Box will be as popular. I think during testing, people will find Lugia's winning because all the lists are playing Manaphy, all the lists are playing Stoutland right now. It's just, there's not much it can do to handle the way Lugia is being built right now. But I do think we start to see other decks come out and have good placements. I think Arceus variants will finally make their mark on the format, whether it be a tanky variant with Duraludon finally breaking through and getting another top 8, or you know, like an Arceus Beedrill or Inteleon Beedrill deck, having a nice run because the Lost Box are not showing up in numbers, I don't think. But I think it's still just going to be a Lugia-dominated event. It's going to be the most played deck, and if you're not taking a favorable matchup, or at least a 50-50 with the mirror, it's probably not worth playing the deck.
Now, Ryan, I was going to say, what are some of your meta predictions here?
I think Lugia is going to probably be like 40% of the meta, honestly. Like, it's just objectively the best deck. I don't think it takes any bad matchups. And there's really not much you can do to tech for the mirror, honestly. I think the lists that were played at LAIC were pretty perfect. Some things that you could try are like Zekrom plus Medicham. So the Zekrom that does 130 in paralysis, and then you either do that twice plus Medicham. But the issue with that is they can just play Sharon's Care or Birdkeeper, and then that's gone. So maybe that was a better call for LAIC than Toronto. I think there's going to be like very little Reggie, since I think everyone's realized that Reggie loses to Lugia. And I don't think Lugia is going to be cutting Dunsparce or Manaphy. I think Mew will. I think people are going to try Mew. I think for sure Judge and Paracel are good inclusions into Mew. Judge instead of Marnie, just to play around the Oranguru. And yeah, I think Lost Box is in an okay spot. I think if you do play Lost Box, you have to play the version with Kyogre and Raikou. I don't really think the Charizard one can beat Lugia because of Stoutland. And yeah, I think there's going to be a lot of the top tables at Toronto being decided off the Lugia Mirror coin flip.
For sure. And LDF, I know you're cooking some sauce now for the weekend ahead. So let me know some of your predictions on what you think, how everything's going to shape up. What do you think you're going to hit the most? Obviously, Lugia is a top contender. So,
yeah, this is the thing with Toronto is we know Lugia did so well at LAIC, and we know a lot of people are going to net deck towards winning lists. Like, a lot of people, like, you got to take into account, this is a lot of people's, like, first regionals, and they're going to want to play something that did well. They're all going to copy towards list. And I think one thing Lugia kind of can maybe falter from is the fact that they have a lack of switch. I don't know if Lugia is going to start teching in Birdkeeper or switch or the Charon's Care. I don't think they're going to start teching those in. And if they don't, then you can try to counter that. I know there's cards like Articuno. There's the Zekrom you talked about earlier. There's other cards, of course, like the Yveltal. Yveltal with like Gallarmine Boss can be very annoying against Lugia. And I think if Lugia does start playing Blissey, that will cause problems for Sanders' control deck. But I think Sanders' control deck has a lot of room for adaption. It was a very like simple list. Like, I remember when everyone was like saying how Sander was playing a control deck and he was doing so well that everyone in my league was like losing their minds because they thought Sander created like another Mewtwo Reunion deck where it just like breaks open the meta and it changes the way we look at like the format. But it kind of just was like an Evil Tall control deck that we've like already seen in like the online tourneys. I know there's like that Evil Tall Ice Cube Miltank Eldegoss deck that already did well before. So I don't think Sander created like a control deck that like changed everyone's perspective on the meta like he did with Mewtwo. Mm-hmm. And I think that the Sander control deck is still good going into LEIC. As long as you have a favored Lugia matchup, that's all you really need. I'm not even sure if Lugia is going to start teching in cards like Switch or Charon's Care or stuff, because I don't think Lugia... I think it'll just be down to the mirror, because like you're not going to want... A lot of the time in the mirror, you're not going to use the Charon's Care. You know, you're never going to really use the Bird Keeper in the mirror that much. So people might not tech it. They're just going to respect their list, say, hey, I'd rather win a mirror match by just being more consistent than my opponent than having these like random tech cards like Charon's Care and like Bird Keeper when they're not going to do anything in a mirror match as opposed to in the actual, like in other matchups, they might be good, but in the Lugia mirror, which is what you are going to expect to see most of the time at Toronto. I think going into Toronto, you have to beat Lugia. You have to take a 50-50 Lugia, obviously, because Lugia is just that good of a deck. I don't think that there really is many options, though, in all honesty. Like, Arc Duraludon seems good, but Lugia's gameplay against Arc Duraludon a lot of the time is they'll, like, knock out a Duraludon before it evolves, KO the Arceus, and then they'll Evil Tall Vacuum the last Duraludon. Obviously, I think we saw that on stream where somebody was playing Arc Duraludon and just got bodied by Lugia because it was like, yeah, Evil Tall can still go through you if they just get rid of the big Parasol. And if Arc Duraludon becomes more popular, which it honestly might, I know a lot of people are going to want to build, you know, good Lugia anti-Lugia decks for Toronto. And I know that Arc Duraludon is maybe what a lot of people consider to be the best one. So Lugia could start just playing like double Vacuum now or something just to counter the Duraludon. But I really think that, you know, you just got to beat Lugia. And I think Arc Duraludon is okay. I'm not even sure Arceus is that good, though, because, like, it just feels so slow against Lugia. Like, Arceus used to be, like, the go first deck, but now it's, like, Lugia just is on another power level compared to Arceus. Lugia does what Arceus does, but even better, because while Arceus can build up, you know, big Vs and stuff, Lugia can build up anything, and it's the same thing, essentially. It's a nice, big, colored V-Star Pokemon. Lugia is just faster than Arceus. I do think Arc Bees is probably good. I actually like the idea of like Arceus Beedrill Flying Pikachu. It's something that like was good at NEIC. I know if I think like Hexter and Ian Robb are on that deck for NEIC, and that honestly is like a deck that might not be bad for Toronto, because Flying Pikachu with like a couple big Parasols can be really good against Lugia. If you knock out their Dunsparce, the Pikachu can take a hit from Lugia, and then you can knock out Lugia's in one hit. You can Parasol Pikachu against Lost Box, which is pretty deadly. The Beedrill is really good against Lugia, too. So Arc Beedrill Pikachu is something that I'm thinking about as, like, a pretty good, like, anti-Lugia deck. Other than that, I think, like, there really isn't many other decks out there. I think Lost Box is kind of the same. I think the Kyogre one, like you said, is probably the best Lost Box deck you have to play. I don't know if the Sableye Kramzar deck is good when Stoutland's popular. Unless, like, you want to try out, like, Lost Box or, like, Galarian Zapdos. I've thought of that. Like, Zapdos can be okay against Stoutland. A lot of the time, if they have to bench Lumineon or a couple Lugias, or the Stoutland, obviously, also on top of that, the Zapdos is attacking for, like, one energy, and you can just one-shot the Stoutland. The prize trade might be awkward, though, so I'm not sure on that one. But, yeah, it's just, like, if you really want to just play a deck, just honestly just play a Lugia deck. It's, like, the most safest thing you can play, and it's the one that'll probably get you the most points.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that even touching on things like the Galarian Zapdos V, there was a 7 months ago, we had a Galarian Zapdos V Beedrill deck that used to take out Mew pretty easily. It used to just snipe it out because it only plays special energies, right?
Right.
So little things like that I've seen pop up here and there. And I think that that's definitely a good call. Again, if you're testing and you find that, you know, you have a really great matchup into the big three, which now I think is control over Lost Box in a sense. But Lost Box and control are kind of next to each other. But Mew and Lugia, if you can test against those and come out with pretty favorable matchups, I think that you're solid. You're ready for the event. So that's kind of bringing us into our next question here. If everybody was going to suggest something to their friend or teammate, what would you play to just get points or get a day two? You know, we know that these are the best decks Everybody's talking about them. There's no secret sauce. Somebody that might be starting back their career in Pokemon in Toronto. What would you suggest playing at an event like this? So, Michael, we'll swing it back over to you and let me know what you think.
To just get points, I think I would go with Mew for sure. I think it's just slightly more consistent than Lugia. It takes a fine Lugia matchup. It might be slightly negative, but I think with Roxanne and the heavy path build, you definitely have enough to, I think it's at least 50-50. So I think Mew's the best play to get points. You're going to be able to just run people over, especially if you're winning coin flips on the day. So I'd definitely go with Mew.
I think if you're just trying to get points, I would recommend the deck John Ang came top four with. The reasons why are because against Duraludon, you need two vacuums, or you don't need it, but it's really good. And I think you'll be, if you're just settling for like a 5-3-1 or 6-2-1 score, you're going to be seeing a lot of Duraludons. I think you're going to also against a lot of Lugia decks, they're not going to expect the Raikou, so they're not going to bench the Dunsparce plus Manaphy to play around it. So I think you'll steal a lot of wins with that. And I think the deck just has a good Mew matchup because it's just Lugia, and I think it has a good Mew matchup because the list is also consistent. And yeah, I think it also has a fine Lost Box matchup. So it's probably the most well-rounded deck. And I was going to say add a Blissey into that list, but probably not. I think you can get away with not playing Blissey.
Yeah, it's fair. Yeah, I was thinking that, like, the Blissey, it's obviously good against control, but honestly, like, how much control are you realistically going to, like, actually play against, right? Obviously, people are going to play it, but is it going to be popular? Control is a harder deck to pilot than most, and I don't know if that'll translate well. Like, a lot of people going to the regionals will just want, like, something easier to play, and they'll play, like, Arctura, or they'll play, you know, Lugia. They won't play control, so would the Blissey really be necessary? Because a lot of the time, it might just have been, like, a bad card in your deck. Like, it just will be a dead card, right? So you might not need the Blissey. I think you're right on that. Like, it's a good idea, but I don't know if control is that. Like, maybe, like, if you make it into day two, or, like, you do maybe, like, top 16, you might expect a couple control, but I honestly don't think day one, it's the chances you find a control deck aren't going to be very high, in my opinion. So.
Yeah, and to add on to that, there's a very, like, narrow, like, I think teching for control is very beneficial for Swiss in day two, because I don't think you'll hit many day one. And if you make day two, then you might hit some day two, but then once you get into that top eight, you actually only need to beat control once. We saw Tord do that with Lugia. And you're actually, control has a very hard time in top eight, just because, I mean, you literally just have to beat it once. And then once time gets called, you just got to take one prize and then you win. And that control takes very long games to deck you out. So you're pretty much always going to time there. So yeah.
Yeah, timing is definitely another issue, especially for newer players going to these regional events. If you're not familiar with a deck and then going in, you're trying to get points and you tie. I know from experience, because I played a control list the last regional I went to. And, you know, tying is unfortunately a thing. And I took that one loss and knocked me out for day two. You know, going into something like this, even if you are going to play control and you think that you're comfortable with it, you have to time yourself so you know that you can take enough of those matchups to get you into the day two. So if you're considering that, I would definitely get yourself, you know, one of those chess timers, or get yourself a little stopwatch and play along with that. But I would say, if you can get the cards, play Lugia, test the mirror match. If you want to get some points, I'm sure. Other than that, I would definitely play Mew. Mew is probably the easiest. And now with the League Battle deck, everybody has access to Mew, so it's super attainable as well. So I think that all of that going forward is definitely the right way to go, right mindset to get yourself a nice day two, some nice points to get to the World CP amount for sure. So I will leave the floor open to our newcomers here to the channel, our friends, and we'll allow you to talk a little bit about any of your socials, anything that you want to plug, whether it's coaching or where people can find you. Katron, we'll go over to you and let me know where people can find you.
Yeah, I mean, all I got is Twitter, at KatronTCG is my Twitter, and then I am I'm also a coach on Medify. Same thing, Catron TCG just got accepted there. So
awesome. Nice.
You can find me on Twitter at Ryan Heckerim. Should probably change that handle soon. and if you want to look, get coaching from me, I only charge $15 an hour, and my Discord is Ryan with two N's and then hashtag 3726. So if you're looking for some last minute coaching for Toronto, hit me up.
Awesome. Well, thank you all very much. And we'll have all of that information down below in the description of this video. Thank you to everybody that joined. Thanks, LDF, for taking some time here with us to talk about the meta. We'll be high-fiving very soon going into this Toronto regional. So we'll be testing our hearts out. We'll see you there. Make sure to stop by and say hi to any of us if you see us out there. We love talking to the people out at regionals here. So I will leave you all with the outro clip here with all of our sponsors. Thank you so much for watching this video for the Meta Call for Toronto, and we'll catch you next time on the Shuffle Squad. The Shuffle Squad is proudly sponsored by Atlas Collectibles, the best place to buy any trading card game product online. Visit atlastcg.com and at the checkout screen, make sure to use code TSS12 to save an unbeatable 12% off your entire order. Atlas Collectibles will ship your product anywhere in the world, so make sure you're taking advantage of the 12% savings with TSS12. And if Pokemon is not your thing, don't worry. Go to atlastcg.com and see all the other amazing trading card game products they have there to offer.
The Shuffle Squad is partnered with PTCGO Store to provide our community with the best access to Pokemon TCG codes. They have codes available 24/7, instant email delivery, and you can save 5% off by using code TSS5. If you're a YouTube member or Patreon supporter, you'll have access to a special code that gets you 10% off. So what are you waiting for? Use code TSS5 today and save 5% on your next order of codes on any codes available at ptcgostore.com.
PokéXWord, the best place to get your fill of Pokemon-inspired puzzles. New puzzles are posted every day, and they recently launched a new Guess That Pokemon puzzle, which is a ton of fun to play. Go check them out at PokéXWord.com and be sure to follow them on Twitter for your chance to win a ton of PTCGO codes every month.
Check out the Late Night Series Season 6, brought to you by myself, Zach Lesage, and the Shuffle Squad. We're going to be running a bunch of sick events for the Pokemon community, and they start on August 30th. So one thing you might be noticing here is that there's an EU time and an NA time. We have one at 12 p.m. Eastern, which works out to about 5 p.m. in London. And then we have one at 7 p.m. Eastern, which should help out a lot of players on the West Coast play in this event. That being said, we still have a lot of cool things going on. Expect similar prizing that we've had for other late night series events. Expect better staffing, expect better tournament experiences. And of course, we do have a stream going up for this season as well, and I will be streaming the event on Twitch. That being said, we have the whole season up on the Play Limitless website. Late Night 51 all the way through 70 runs until we hit the Invitational on November 5th. So check that out, sign up today, and support Zach Lesage Events and the Shuffle Squad. See you there.